In the last video, if I remember correctly, because it was a good month ago now, I drew a graph out and we worked through it with Dijkstra. And at the end, I pointed out a couple of problems. So let's just remind ourselves of those problems. And then when we talk about A star, we can see how it addresses it. The problem is that Dijkstra will follow the path that's currently shortest. And doesn't pay any attention to what direction it's going. So if I'm coming down here to my end goal and I'm starting up here, that's fine if the weights are all the same, because it will look a bit up here, but it will get there quite quick. The problem is, of course, if you've got the map of the UK and it's searching quickly down all the nice motorways, when in fact, actually, we don't need to go down any motorways, it's a country road drive or something like this. Now, of course, in practice, it wouldn't take very long still, because, you know, computers are quite fast. But the whole point of these algorithms is they're quick. And you can imagine, if you're writing a sat nav, you don't want it to take a long time churning through roads unnecessarily. The other problem is, if your graph doesn't look like a map, because, you know, in some sense, the UK road network is quite sparse, right? Most of the country doesn't have road on it. It's mostly fields and sheep and stuff, but, you know, or houses. If you have a situation where you've got quite a dense network like this, so I guess you could say a bit like Manhattan, but also just, you know, another problem where your graph structure is different. So if you're looking through an image or something like this, I'm starting up here and just cross that out. There we are. And I'm finishing down, I don't know, here. Let's remember that Dijkstra follows the shortest path based on the distance of each of these. Now, if this is just sort of a uniform grid, let's say, and we have no interesting information to provide for these weights, then all these weights, let's say, are one. So it's just going to flood fill through here. So it's going to go here, and then here, and then to these three, and then to these four, and so on. And that's not very optimal, right? Especially if we just literally just want to go straight down here, like this. So we want to build in some kind of idea of, not necessarily the direction we're heading, but we are at least going towards our goal, so that we can aim for it. And that's what A star does. A star is basically a small extension to Dijkstra that builds in a heuristic that says we're getting a bit closer. This is our nice screwed up graph from last time. And this is our nice new fresh graph that I've done, which is topologically exactly the same. I may have traced it. So we could do Dijkstra on this. I've got my little cards for my priority queue, right? I've reminded myself how the end condition is so I can end it properly. That's all fine. What we want to do is extend this to A star. Now, A star is basically exactly the same as Dijkstra, except it has an additional heuristic that is how far do we have to go, right? And in this case, a pretty reasonable heuristic to come up with will be the literal Euclidean distance of how far we have to go. So in this case, S to E will be that far, C to E will be that far, and so on. I couldn't think of a good way of calculating this without literally just measuring it. So I've got my...
dainty...
Yeah, it's Vic's 10 metre tape measure, which is a little bit overkill, but we'll make it work. So this is all a bit odd. I don't use tape measures much, as you can imagine, because mostly I just sit at a desk and do typing. This is a tape measure in centimetres and inches. Let's use inches today, right? Imperial, woo. So I'm going to literally measure the amount of inches from S to E, and then A to E, and I'm going to just put this on here now, right? And this is where you fast forward. So I'm going to use the black pen for this. So let's say this is 10, there. This is harder than I thought it would be. I haven't got enough hands. 8. A 6. I'm rounding up a bit, it's not very accurate. 4. So the green ones are our step distances for Dijkstra, and the black ones are measured inches. Also 3, 6, 7. We're getting there. 6 again. Right, that's me doing my workman's. Now, we've got exactly the same graph as before, but now we have some measure of the distance to our thing. It's not a very good heuristic in the sense that my measuring is not very accurate, and for A star to work really well, you have to have a consistent metric and you have to not overestimate how far you've got to go and things like this. But we'll just hope it will work itself out. It can't be any worse than me, you know, doing it by hand anyway. So recall when we did Dijkstra, what we had was we had some queue here like this. These had the current distance from the start to these nodes. And if one of the nodes had a shorter path, it would move up the queue. And then when we wanted to expand a node, we'd take it off the queue. Now, A star works exactly the same way, except the distance isn't what we order them by anymore. It's the distance of the path plus how far they have to go. So, for example, at B, the distance is going to be 2 plus 7, which is 9, right? So B will have a value of 9 on this queue. And the idea is that if something has a long way to go, it's going to receive a higher weight and be further down the queue and expanded later. What it will do is prioritize nodes that are going roughly in the right direction. Unless, it'll still go down really good paths, really short paths, but not at the expense of everything else, is the idea. Okay, so let's run through this, just like we did with Dijkstra, and hopefully I won't make any mistakes. People will very kindly point them out if I do. Oh, look, checkered flag. This is why I don't draw things, because it's never good. Right, okay, we're starting at S. I'm not going to draw the infinity symbols on because we know that all of these nodes start with a distance of infinity because we don't know how far the path is. In Dijkstra, we stored the distance to each path and we also ordered by that distance. We've now got two separate measures we're measuring in A star. One is the distance to the node and one is the distance to the node and any remaining distance. So we kind of need to have two values on each of these things. So I'm going to try and keep the colours the same so that we don't lose track. So anything I draw in green is going to be this g cost function, which is the distance to a current node. So for C, that would be 3. And then in black, I'm going to have 3 + 8, which is this sort of combined cost, the thing we're actually ordering by. Okay, so the path cost to S is 0, and the sort of distance to go is 10, but it won't matter because S is the only thing in our queue, so we'll put S in the queue. Right, everything else has a distance to infinity. So let's start expanding some stuff. So A first, I've got to find A, right? Fast forward, here we are. Why aren't these in alphabetical order? I mean, you know, what was I thinking? Right, so A has a distance of 7 and a combined distance of 9 + 7, which is 16. The same for B, so again, B's, I mean, it's actually at the end, unbelievable. I tell you what, I'm gonna keep C at the top now because I know that's coming. Okay, so B has a weight of 2 and a combined cost of 7 + 2, which is 9. So we're going to put that in there. Now B goes in the queue and goes ahead of A because 9 is smaller than 16. Right? We're keeping a track of these green distances, but we're not actually using them to see which one comes next. And then C has a path cost of 3 and then a combined weight of 11. 8 + 3, and then that goes in just above A like this, right? So actually, so far, pretty similar to Dijkstra, apart from some of the numbers have changed. So what's next? Well, we start expanding B. I haven't been keeping a track of the previous node. So all of these currently, let's draw them in red, all are going through S at the moment. Okay, so B next. We can go to A. A has a distance of 7. When we're deciding whether the path to A is better via B, we don't care about this heuristic. We only care about the actual cost of a path to A. So in this case, 2 + 3 is less than 7. So just like with Dijkstra, we're going to replace it. So A, is its new weight is going to be 5, and 16 is going to be 5 + 9. So 14, right? And this path is going through B. Do you think I can turn that S into a B? Oh yes, there we go, look at that. So it stays below C, it's not a big deal. Okay, D, let's find D in my shuffled list. If you're implementing this, don't shuffle it because it'll be that much harder to find in memory. Right, there we are. B has a path length of 2, D has a path length of 4, so that's a path length of 6, and D has got a distance to 8 to the end. So actually, you can see here that D is traveling forward in this direction, but it's actually getting further away than B. So D's going to be quite heavily penalised. That's our hope. So D's not going to be expanded for a while. We're not going to look there until it's a last resort. So 8 + 4 is 12. So 12, and that path goes through, you know what, I'm just going to leave the lids off. And that goes through B. All right, so we put that in, and that goes above A, because A is a terrible one. Remember, there's a fallen tree on that one. But it's still pretty bad. And then finally H. Now H has a path length of 1, which is nice and quick. B has a path length of 2. So the total path cost is 3, and the actual heuristic cost is 3 + 6, which is 9. That's 9 in here. 9's looking pretty good right now. Now H goes straight above everything, like this, right? B's about to pop out, so that's good. So B is finished, and we put B on our finished pack, our finished stack. Finished list, yeah. Finished data structure over here. Next up is H, right? Now, last time we didn't expand H next, we expanded C next. In Dijkstra, because they had the same rough path cost, which is 3, and C was already in the list. So now we're already starting to move a little bit faster with A star, which is good because it means my example is working. So H comes off, and let's see where we can go. We can go to F, so that's easy, I'll find F. F has a path cost of 3 + 3, which is 6, and it has a distance to go of 6, so that's total heuristic cost of 12, and it's going through H. Right, this goes in, and it will come in behind D here. With a path cost also of 12. right? In general, if there's a conflict, we'll just put the first one in. You know, it depends on your implementation. G has a path cost of 3 from H plus another 2, so that's 5, and then plus another 3 is 8. Okay, we're done with H. G goes in right at the top, which is good news for us, for our nice elegant search. So we're going to expand G, so where's E? But I'm not going to go off half cock this time and finish my algorithm here. G has a path length of 5, and so E has a path length of 7. See, now I've drawn this checkered flag and it's in the way of my numbers. Thanks for suggesting that. Right, E has a heuristic cost of 0 because we're at the goal. So actually 7 is the final value that we get given here. And this goes through G. And we're going to put E in. So E goes in here. G's not really on the stack anymore. G can't expand anywhere else. We've already been to H. And so the next iteration of the algorithm starts, right? We pop E off the top. We're about to expand it and we realize that's where we're going. And we finished our algorithm, okay? And so then, just like before, we trace back through. So E goes to G, and then, where's my G? There it is. G goes to H, and then H goes to B, and B goes to S, and S is a start. Right, so we've got our path, S, B, H, G, E. Now, in this case, it's exactly the same path as Dijkstra, because I picked a fairly reasonable heuristic, right? Plus or minus a bit of my dodgy measuring. But you can see, we didn't bother to expand C, or L, or even consider I and J, many fewer nodes got put in the stack in both terms of the amount of computation we did and the memory footprint we was reduced. And we still obtained the same result.
So there were one or two comments on the last video about not expanding nodes, but you're saying that on A star you definitely don't have to expand those.
No, the comments on the video were because basically I forgot to wait until E was expanded to finish. I got overexcited and as soon as I saw E, I declared it over and we went and got a coffee. And that's not right, because technically speaking, there could have been a path from, say, F to E that was super sneaky and really quick, right? I'm sure super sneaky is not the technical term you see in the literature. And if that had happened, we have to wait until E bubbles to the top of our priority queue to be able to know for sure that we've got the shortest path. In this case, it was very straightforward. E went straight to the top. But you can never guarantee, and a different graph will have a different thing. So the actual stopping criterion for both Dijkstra and A star is when your goal node gets to the top of your priority queue. But yeah, that was good that people pointed that out because it completed the video with a bit of extra comments. To wrap up, you can imagine now that we've seen a video on how SatLav works in terms of GPS positions. And we've seen a couple of videos on path finding and there's lots of videos on data structures and things like this. You can imagine now that you might start to think, oh, I could actually see how a SatNav might be implemented. I could see, you know, the parts of the system that have to work together. We've got a map that's stored in the memory. We've got nodes that we're trying to get to and from, and we've got an algorithm that will find a way through. Now, you can imagine also that it's unrealistic to expect a small SatNav to completely compute its way through the UK. Like, if you say, I want the best path from Land's End to John O'Groats, you might melt your SatNav, unless you do something a little bit smarter. So you can imagine they might pre-compute some of these things. Like, they know that the shortest way of getting from Nottingham to London is via the M1, or something like this, to sort of hard-code some of it in some sense. To be honest, I don't work for a SatNav company. I don't know what their proprietary algorithms are. But you can see, this is the kind of thing we're doing. We're trying to find a nice, elegant way of getting from A to B. And there's lots of pathfinding algorithms. And you could come up with lots of interesting heuristics, not just Euclidean distance.
Also, of course, they're going to have GPS to measure rather than your dainty little...
I mean, yeah, although I would say that GPS often has an accuracy of plus or minus a few metres. So my shoddy measuring tape is actually pinpoint precision compared to that. They'll have maps that are carefully crafted with the exact known positions of all of these junctions, and they know how long it takes you to travel round a roundabout, and they know how long this takes because of the traffic and things like this. They're going to be doing a lot smarter algorithms than I am doing, but this is a start, and you can see that you could build this up into a really good system.